Hello, I'm Charles Fisher of FishDuck.com, and we have a very special fish report titled The Trojan Game Plan and How Oregon Will Beat USC in 2012.
One of the most highly anticipated games in all of college football will be the epic matchup of Oregon at USC on November 3rd. The vast majority of expert commentary about last year's game has been mostly accurate, but highly incomplete from a Trojan perspective. We will look at what Oregon can do to win this year, but of more importance, examine the game plan that Lane Kiffin devised in 2011, as we can expect to see it again from the Trojans and a few other opponents that might have the personnel to implement their plan. Let's look at Oregon first from a mental readiness assessment, and then why we only scored 35 points on offense. We'll look at our defense later when we study the offensive game plan of USC. We did have an energy hangover effect from the very intense Stanford game the week before, and I admit as a fan not having the same fear of Troy as in past years due to the Trojans' loss to the Cardinal and the Sun Devils. USC was only ranked 18th going into our game. The game's at our home, do our thing and we're fine. Southern Cal was ready to play and did so superbly. That fine edge of not being as fired up can make all the difference with two very talented teams. This year we will not have a draining game the week before, and our players can't wait to play the Trojans again. This is a huge difference in mental positioning, which alone could be the difference in 2012. How many times last year did we say, we're a second half team? The fans and the team became too comfortable with this ace in our pocket. You cannot get behind 14-0, 24-7, and 38-14 and expect to come back and win. We all intuitively knew that it couldn't last forever, and this was a huge lesson that will pay off for the team for years to come. Yes, this year our team will not be constrained by an emotional hangover or overconfidence in our second half play, and it will improve our performance substantially. On offense, we simply need to clean up the mistakes that helped turn the game away from us. First, we see a wide receiver screen that was dropped, and look at the replay from behind at the wide open field with blocks set or about to be set downfield. It was a touchdown lost, and since it was on fourth down, we did not score on this possession. That is a gut grinder. We made the right play call, blocked it well, and set up the touchdown, and then we literally dropped the ball. Ugh. Just before halftime, we have a wide open DeAnthony Thomas, who is overthrown by just a hair. Touchdown called back. Two plays later, we fumbled, and while the defensive play of the Trojans was deserved and well done, it shouldn't have happened had we not overthrown an easy pass. That's two touchdowns lost in the first half, and we went into halftime down 21-7. On the final drive of the game, we underthrow a wheel route to Dat, and let's just let Herbie explain.
If Darren Thomas leads him, he walks into the end zone for a touchdown.
If DeAnthony is led by the pass, he cruises into the end zone, and we win 42-38 right there. We scored an average of 50 points the prior 2 years against USC, and with the three TDs lost on errors tacked on the 35 points we had this year, we score in the 50s again. Monty Kiffin did not do anything new or amazing with his defense. We just messed up. You have heard from the players and Chip Kelly that the biggest obstacle to our offense is us stopping ourselves and not playing our game. This was Exhibit A of this concept in reality. Execute our offense better and we win. It is that simple.
What's the coolest new Oregon football item? It's the O that shows your loyalty to our beloved Ducks. I've got two and I love them both. They're perfect for the office, your bedroom, and especially your entertainment room or man cave as I have. They're easy to install and move without damaging walls, and the sticker command strips are provided. The best part? They're produced right here in Oregon by Arden Duck fans. Which is better, the yellow or the carbon? It's good or good. And get them autographed. Help this site and a loyal duck by ordering from d1logo.com, and I know you will love them as I do.
One coach told me that he realized that Lane Kiffin came of age in this game and has proven himself as a good coach. Why? For once he didn't trip himself up. Often he would put in something new or screwy like a wildcat formation. Or some other new stuff introduced on Thursday with little time for the team to practice and refine it. He was known to shoot himself in the foot until this game.
And you know what? The coach is blaming himself on this. There's no question.
It's almost like they've gotten too cute. He's trying to change the play right there at the last moment. Again, this is something new for USC. They've just picked this up in the last few weeks. And trying to execute this against Oregon in this big a game, the first drive, it led to a touchdown. This time it backfires.
He devised a great game plan and stuck to it. Let's take a look. Look how Darren Thomas went through the progressions on this play until he found the fifth receiver open for a big gain. That works if you have the time, the protection from the rush. In prior games against USC, we blitzed extremely well and stopped many of their drives, which made the difference in those games. Barkley did not get comfortable, which is imperative considering how accurate he has become. Pressuring him is key for us. For the first time, our zone blitzes confused Andrew Luck as we improved our tactics to the point to where we were confusing everybody we played. Lane Kiffin did not want his All-American quarterback to be fodder for our blitzers, and he did not want his offense to get confused as in prior years. So here is his game plan. First, USC threw quick, short patterns that could get some yak yards after catch. Thus, no blitzing would get to Barkley, and short patterns can materialize in a hole from the vacating blitzer in the short zones in the secondary. No confusion, no sacks, and easy yardage for the visitors while Oregon is going crazy trying to get to Barkley in only 2 seconds. Sticking their quarterback for losses wasn't going to happen, as you didn't see slants, hooks, or crossing patterns hardly at all from USC. There was no need, as these short, quick patterns were working just fine for the Trojans. This strategy negated our blitzing extremely well. Second, Lane went to the running game for balance. In the past, Oregon did not fear the USC ground game and usually kept it in reasonable check. That trend continued for us until late first quarter when Deion Jordan went out of the game with an injury. What you hear from most pundits is how our pass rush was dramatically reduced by the loss of Jordan. And that is baloney, as we now know that with the short, quick passing attack of Troy in this game, Jordan wasn't going to get to Barkley anyway. Where we missed him was as a run defender. Our replacement had done a ton of great things for us in his career, but he had a tough evening trying to defeat blocks. The USC tight ends did a fantastic job blocking our backup drop end, and it really opened up their running game. Contrary to popular thought, the loss of Deion Jordan helped the Trojan running game the most. The third component of the Lane Kiffin game plan was to throw deep to his talented wide receivers over our freshman corners. They did this off of play action or quick throws, but their wide receivers are the nation's best too, and that would have been a tough matchup for any corner. These freshmen played great football for us and made some good plays as freshmen, and they will improve enormously in their next year. It has been said that if the starters we planned on had not been hurt or held out in Cliff Harris and Anthony Gilden, then we could have won. That's true, but as we've seen, we lost for a bunch of other reasons, and I haven't even mentioned missing a 37-yard field goal straight on with no wind badly. There was blame to go around, and these young guns at corner will knock down a bunch of those passes this year. If our corners can cut the long passes in half, can USC score enough points with the short passes and a running game? It's a good question, but there is no doubt their freshmen will be better. They are at home, and they are well-coached as well as talented. They are good, but I believe we have more upside to our potential than they do. But then that is my view through green-tinted glasses. There will be cheap shots from USC as in the past, and infantile delaying tactics as their sense of entitlement has gone unfulfilled lately. These things will happen to us when we are the returning 3-time conference champions, no matter. I acknowledge that they have a great team of talent and coaching, but they also got the biggest pop in rankings ever from beating Oregon. They were 18th in the AP poll going into the game, and they move up into the top 5 at the end of the season without a bowl game to confirm their ranking? Now they're a top 3 pick going into the season based on 1 3-point victory? It makes the game that much more interesting for us all. Can Oregon clean up the mistakes on offense? Can USC continue to do well with the long jump ball? This is a great game for the conference and promises to be a big one in the upcoming long line of superb Oregon-USC games of the future. I'm ready for them to strap it up right now.
I took 4 pages of notes from Coach Mike Morris's astute observations of this game and shamelessly explained them as if I was the expert, which I'm not. Coach Mike may be retired, but he sure knows his football, and he's generously given his expertise for all of us. Thanks, Coach.
We have some highly unique talent returning to Oregon this fall, which begs the question of, what is the most important offensive play for 2012? Next week, we will look at the unusual skills of some of our players to determine which offensive play will set the tone and be the most feared by conference defenses. I think the conclusion will surprise you as I stick my neck out with this prediction, and it will make the season that much more interesting as to whether this special play will have the impact that I project. Give some thought to our players and the plays. Which do you think it will be? That will be next week.
Oh, how we love to learn about our beloved Ducks. I'm Charles Fisher, Fish Duck, and to learn more about Oregon football, come to fishduck.com.